Do you know that today in the world, half of the population of the world actually live in cities? So cities are very important to us. But cities also give us a lot of challenges, especially the architect planners, because most of them face a growing population. Not only is the population growing, but it's aging. And people continue to have aspirations for better quality of life. And as the cities grow, we would have to develop more infrastructure and services for them, and we have to make sure that these services work. And with climate change, we have to encourage people to use less energy so that we reduce carbon emissions. So cities seek solutions to address these challenges. How do we deal with them? Well, many cities are starting to adopt smart technology to improve our environment and our daily living. But what is smart technology? Everybody talks about being smart. Well, in very simple form, it is really harnessing infocom technology, the Internet of Things, and harnessing the power of data, getting insights into data to actually develop smart applications that make the day-to-day living for us comfortable. It has been projected that by 2025, we will have at least 88 smart cities in the world. What about Singapore? Well, the Prime Minister has said that our vision is for Singapore to be a smart nation, a nation where people live meaningful and fulfilled lives, enabled seamlessly by technology, offering exciting opportunities for all. Note that it's really about people and not about just the technology. But are we ready to be smart? Well, I think we are pretty much on the journey. We are quite wired up. 90% of our homes have broadband, and we're going to bring fiber to every home. And Singapore has one of the highest smartphone penetration rate in the world, at about 85%. So we are on the journey. But what is a smart nation? I just like to illustrate with an example of a HDB town, a public housing town close to my heart. And I call it the Heartlands. Why is it the Heartlands? Because it houses 83% of the population, and many of you and I live in HDB towns, in about a million flats. So what is a smart town? The smart town really functions like the human body. We have all the buildings in there where activities take place, like the muscles in our body. We have greenery and parks, like our lungs, that help to cleanse the air for us and to give us oxygen to breathe. And we have all the roads, just like the veins and arteries in our bodies that move the traffic, the people and the goods. And you know, our body has the 5 senses. And the sensors sent to our brain, it senses what happens in the environment and tells our brain how to get the body to adapt, whether it's hot or it's cold. So if you add a sensor layer onto a town, it collects data. And insights from this data can help the town to continue to learn and to adapt. And from this, we can develop smart applications for day-to-day living. As an architect planner, actually, I plan and build many of the towns that you live in. And I would very much like to build a smart town that is livable, efficient, sustainable, and safe for you. We are going to look at smart in 4 areas: smart planning, smart environment, smart estate services, and smart living. What is smart planning? As an architect planner, I love this part because it helps me to design a better living environment for you. Now, what is smart planning? Basically, the first thing I do is to collect all the data about town, the buildings, the roads, the parks, and I put it into the computer. And I'll also collect a lot of information about energy use and waste, for example. And with this information, I can develop a 3-dimensional map of Singapore in the computer. Now, what do I do with this information? Well, I can do a lot. I can do a computer model that simulates the wind flows through the town. We're in the tropics, we love the wind. We're not in Chicago. Now, if you look at this diagram, the colors that are yellow and orange means that the wind flows are pretty good. The ones in blue means it's a little bit, it doesn't move so much. So when we did the first cut of Punggol Eco Town, this was the pattern of the wind flow. And then we adjusted the buildings, we moved the parks around, and then you find that the wind flows improve. You see more of the orange and the red colors, which means you get a cooler and a better air quality through the town. Computer simulations can do many things. It can do it at a town level, or we can do it at a precinct level, and we can even do it at a building level. So welcome to Punggol North Shore. It's a town that we've precinct we've just designed, which I've just launched for sale. I don't know how many of you applied for a flat there, but I highly recommend it. It's a great place to live, all right? Now, in the design, similarly, when we first did the design, we looked at the wind flows through the town. And like at a town level, we also made adjustments to the design. I moved things around, cut holes in the buildings, and you can see that the wind flows have improved, particularly in the neighborhood center. All right, we wanted a lot of natural ventilation so that we can minimize the use of air conditioning. Now, computer simulations can also help you in many ways. It can do a shadow analysis of the town. Here you see the shadows moving from morning till night. Why is it important? Well, it helps the architect and the planner to decide where to put the park and the outdoor dining areas or the outdoor plazas or playgrounds and my childcare center. I like to put them in the shade so that the children can be out the whole day. The computer can also tell you the solar irradiance in a town. How much sun actually falls on the surfaces of the town and on the buildings? And why is this useful? Well, it helps me to decide, for example, where there's moderate sunshine, I'm going to put the roof gardens there. And when there's a lot of sunshine, that's where I put my solar panels. We talked about solar panels, and it is very effective. All this information helps the architect to design the town, not only aesthetically, but also to ensure that it is functional. So this is a waterfront town, quite nice. You can start applying for it. Now, we can add a layer of sensors to the town, all right? Can have a layer of sensors that tells you about the humidity, the heat, the wind flows, and all this data that I collect can go back into the computer systems to validate the assumptions and make it even more accurate. But more importantly, it can be used in many ways. For example, in my neighborhood center, I have these huge fans. Now, I hope that these fans can be triggered when I collect data on, when I monitor the humidity and the heat. They will be triggered when it hits a certain threshold level. But that is a greenfield site. What about old towns? So welcome to Yihua, Jurong, and old estate. What we did a couple of years ago is to try to introduce a lot of sustainability initiatives into this estate to make it greener, which means more cycling, more solar panels for clean energy. We put in rainwater harvesting systems. But can I make it even smarter so that they are more effective? So, for example, we have put a lot of solar panels on hundreds of buildings on HDB blocks. You may not see it because you didn't climb up to the roof. Now, we put in sensors to all the solar panels and we track the energy that's collected. And we know immediately when a panel is not working because it would not be collecting energy and we can fix it. But do you know that such data collected can do many things? It can even tell you the weather condition. For example, if many of our solar panels are not collecting a lot of energy, it might mean that over that town, it is cloudy or it is actually rainy. So it's a proxy to the meteorological station. Another service that we see a lot in town, estate service we're very familiar with, is the lighting along your corridor. Now, how many of you walk into a toilet and it suddenly switches on and you get a shock from dark to light? Right? Well, smart sensors allow a person to walk along a corridor. It can even predict where you're going, and then the lighting level picks up. And when you have passed it, the lighting level dims again, and you save energy. And the data collected is useful because if along that corridor, after 11 p.m. every night, very few people actually walk there, the system is smart enough to learn the pattern and to reduce the brightness of the light and save energy. Another estate service we're all very familiar with is the lift. We have 24,000 lifts in HDB towns, and we monitor it every day. Now, when you're sleeping at night, you may not know this, but we move the lifts when you're sleeping. All right? There's no ghost. We move it. The reason being that we're testing it to make sure it works when you take the lift the next day, right? Now, we, of course, when the lift breaks down, we will get a signal and we have to go and fix it. But you know, with the new sensors, maybe you can even monitor the vibration and the heat generation from the lift, and it can even predict a potential failure before it even happens so that we can go and fix it first. So that's wonderful, right? To be able to predict. Now, this is a map of Singapore, and if you look closely, you think there are a lot of ants running around. Now, these little movements, actually, this is real time. It shows you where all the taxis are moving around in Singapore. But why do we want to collect such data? It's great data for transport planners because by looking at this data, the transport planner knows the road condition and where's the congestion. Now, we can push this data out to you to all your smartphones. I'm sure all of you have smartphones, all right? And you know straight away which road to avoid, going home from NTU later to wherever you come from. You know, you have your EasyLink card, right? Every time you go up the bus, you tap the EasyLink card. Now, that data is very useful because when we collect that data, we can tell you which bus is crowded. So when you're waiting for your bus, on your handphone, you will be able to find out that this bus that's coming is going to be crowded. So you might want to take another bus or change a route, all right? So such information and data is very useful. Now, next, I talked about smart living, all right, closer to home. By 2030, we will double the people who are over 65 years old from 450,000 to about 900,000. In 1970, about 13 people support one person who is over 65 years old. By 2030, there are only two of us supporting a parent who's over 65 years old. And with dual-income families, it means that many of us may not be home and our parents are left alone. Well, meet two of my residents. This is Doris, and her mom is 78 years old. And Doris has to go to work, all right? She has to cater to the family, and she takes care of her mom. But she's always worried, because her mom once had a fall at home, so she's very worried when she's at work. So what we did was we pilot-tested a system called CMAS, Smart Elderly Monitoring Alert System, in her home. So what we did was we went into a home and we fixed a little sensor, or a couple of sensors throughout the home. And what this sensor does is it monitors the movements of her mum, but it don't just monitor, it learns her pattern over a few weeks. For example, the time that she wakes up. Now, if this pattern is broken, it becomes very irregular or there's no movement at home, what happens is that a signal is automatically sent to Doris's handphone when she's at work. And Doris can quickly call home and check if her mom is all right or to alert a neighbor to knock on the door. And I think this gives Doris a lot of peace of mind. So with an aging population, such smart solutions are actually very useful. Another application is telehealth. When you're at work and mom has no one to send her to the hospital, she may not need to go to the hospital. She can be home and do her physiotherapy with a nurse watching her and training her to make sure that she's doing it correctly. She can do this in the comfort of the living room. And in fact, her heartbeat can be monitored and her blood pressure can be monitored. And so it is very convenient. But of course, if she needs to go to the hospital, the nurse will tell her, you need to come into the hospital. So I think another very useful application is the home energy management system. I think everyone is quite familiar with this. It tells you how much energy your appliances are using at home. But the smart solutions can even alert you when they reach a certain usage. It can even switch off your devices when you're not at home. And do you know that it can even do this? When you go to bed at night and you turn on the air conditioner, a lot of you like to be very cool, I don't know what temperature, 18, 20, 21, all right? But it uses a lot of energy. So what happens is, after you're asleep, very quietly, the device is going to raise the temperature of your air conditioner, and you won't even know it. And therefore, you save energy. So I think all these applications can make our daily living better. But of course, we'll have to select the right technology. We have to make it very friendly. And frankly, the CIMA system I showed you, actually, Doris's mum found it very easy to use. And of course, we have to make sure that we strengthen cybersecurity because we're collecting a lot of data. And I believe that while cities are a great challenge to us, if we can find the right smart solutions, we can make Singapore a much better home. Thank you.